Hi, I'm Roberto Martinez, and you're watching Toffee TV.
Welcome back to Toffee TV with me, Ped, with Baz, and we're joined in the studio by a couple of people that I wouldn't want to meet in a dark alley, and that's not to do with your faces, lads. With Jazz Dickens and Steve Lewis, who are going to be on the card on the 6th of March at the Echo Arena. It is going to be a big scrap, Royal Rumble style, with all Scouse lads, no one missing. Great to have you here, lads. Thanks for joining us. First of all, 6th of March, Jazz, let's start with you. Big fight on the horizon. Are you looking forward to it?
Yeah, can't wait. Been training for a long time for this fight, and I'm looking forward to winning the Lonsdale title in front of my own fans in Liverpool.
What's it like? I mean, what's it like fighting at home, Echo Arena? I mean, what's that like? I mean, I'm sure now, I mean, there's been a lot of other Scouse fighters, but for you personally, what's it like to be fighting at home?
It's unbelievable, especially in the Echo Arena. I remember when they built the Echo Arena and walking past as a little kid, but my mum saying, I'm going to fight in there one day, mum. So the first title I won was the English title that was in the Echo Arena in front of loads of Scousers, and it's a better feeling in front of loads of Scousers than people you don't know.
The only disappointing thing is that it's not Everton's ground. That's the only disappointing thing. It should be Everton's ground, shouldn't it? Ring-fenced money. We first saw you, I first saw you on the Channel 4 documentary, Knockout Scousers, just before the Olympics in 2012. At the time, you were going for the Olympics, and massively on the show, you dropped out to turn professional. I mean, how did that all come about?
As in football and most sports, there's a lot of politics back behind the scenes, what you don't see, and I always wanted to be professional, and I came to the end of my wits early with the politics, so I thought, why not be happy and turn professional now while I'm young and get a good advantage on the people who were going to be waiting to go to the Olympics but might not go and stuff like that, and to get a good advantage. There's people turning pro now who are in the same position as me who were only fighting their first pro fights now, so I'm fighting for the British title for the second time around within them 3 or 4 years.
Is that the frustration? Because when you're fighting and you are amateur and you're relying on other people's facilities and being picked for those facilities, because in the show I remember you were training in some, well, less glamorous conditions than other people in that. Is that the frustration?
Yeah, when you're on a Great Britain squad, you're provided for, but that comes at a cost. Like, you have to do what they say and stuff like that. I'm much happier training where I train with people who love and stuff like that, so I'd rather be doing what I want to do, be my own boss and do
something for a little wage, as a lot of them fighters do. A lot of them are happy just getting paid and going through the motions, whereas if you've got big dreams, you have to follow them.
And you're a proper Evertonian as well, because you were born in Mill Lane. That means you were born in Everton. It's one thing I'm really disappointed with my mother about, Baz, if I'm honest, that she chose Oxford Street instead of
just drive here and
go to Mill Lane.
And I was Oxford Street as well, mate, so.
No one's born in Mill Lane.
Listen, we might have shoddy equipment. We do research, mate. We do research. We're not that bad. We're going to get someone in. We're going to look after them properly.
Stay, not to leave you out. You're a little bit behind Jazza in terms of where you are in your career, but I was like looking, doing a bit of research, as we've just mentioned, and you had a really good amateur career. How did you come about to make the decision to turn pro, or is it something that you've always wanted?
It's something that I've always wanted, okay. But it got to a point where I was got about to go on the senior AVAs, but I had like a 6 to 8 months where I thought I've had enough with boxing. So I ended up leaving it, then missed the ABAs, and then when I come back, it was just club shows. So I decided it was time to try something else and turn pro. I always wanted to do it, so I just felt the time was right.
So. What have you found being the biggest difference between being an amateur and now a pro?
Not that I didn't take it serious in the amateurs, but you really do have to take it a lot more serious. It becomes your life, not just like a hobby or a sport you do. It's your job, it's everything you're doing, you know what I mean? So you've got to change your whole lifestyle, really.
And is there much differences in the scoring and things like that between amateur and pro? Or?
Yeah, like they've changed the scoring now, but when I was amateur, it was point scoring, so you could have a box round and then you could get the round stole off you in the last 10 seconds, but you're getting caught with three stupid shots, you know what I mean? Whereas it's totally different in the pros. You can work your fight round. You're all plan for the fight, you know what I mean? You haven't got to worry about getting it with one shot and losing the fight. So
come to terms with that.
Yeah. Come to terms with it.
You're fighting Josh Wade as well. I mean, you're coming off a couple of victories. You've only had one defeat in your career. Are you trying to get yourself back onto that level again where you're gonna be looking to fight for, you know, major titles again?
Yeah, last time I fought for the British title, I lost the British title. I remember getting out of the ring looking at the Lonsdale belt thinking, I'll be back for you. I'm coming back, and now going back to the Echo, I'm thinking I'm going to get my belt, and then I'm looking forward to moving on. It's sort of like redemption for me, if that makes sense. But I do because I enjoy it, but there's also a bit of redemption in what that belt and coming together.
I can't say I'm a massive boxing fan. I mean, I don't mean that in a bad way, but when you're on the outside looking in, you look at people and they've got, you know, no notes in that loss column. But then doesn't mean they're a better fighter than someone like yourself who's got that one, because that's at times that's a gripe I have with boxing. You look at it and you think something's not right here, and I don't mean things getting fixed, but people getting pushed in a certain direction so that you make sure they don't lose fights. Do you look at that one and just think, I'll learn from that, I have learned from that, and it's going to give me that motivation to make sure I do get where I want to go?
Yeah, I've had 19 fights and I've won 18, and I learned more from the one loss than I did all the rest of the fights. And don't get me wrong, I've boxed a lot of tomato cans, people who you have to fight, the enemy coming up, and it is frustrating, and when you're watching the telly and people have paid for good money to watch the bills, and they're fighting tomato cans, so that can be frustrating sometimes, but that's your learning curve, and you need them people as well. They say that journeymen make boxing. Without them, what would we learn and stuff like that? So
that could be
it's an
interview
for me.
That could be an interview. Just standing against the everywhere. That could be boss. I could just stay in my little ways. Practically being on the taxis anyway, so might as well. Obviously, we live in a city where at the moment it's fantastic boxing wise. You know, there's a few on the bill, you know, on the 6th of March in the Echo Arena. We've got the Smiths, we've got Tony Bellew, we've got David Price, we've got Derry Matthews, we've got all these names. Now, I'm sure it's fantastic because you can get on a card like this, but you'd ever feel slightly lost amongst them because you are from Liverpool and you've got all these big names ahead of you? Or are they all there to aspire to?
It's nice to be the big fish in a small pond, or I don't know if it's small fish in a big pond, I don't know, but you have to also sell tickets. That's a big part of boxing. And if you can't sell tickets, these selling tickets to all your mates, and you can't sell none, and you won't be pushed really. You know what I mean? You have to also see that side too, but what not many people do see.
Yeah, so yeah, I mean, obviously, if you're on a fight, obviously, you've got like one of the Smiths on this fight, you know, Derry Matthews, you're going to bring people in, then the pressure's off, I suppose. You can just go and have a fight and know that the Echo Arena should be full.
You still got to sell your tickets, you know what I mean? I think that's what he might have meant a little bit. Like, we sort of say we know same people, so I'll ask people if they want to buy tickets, and they're like, no, what if they bought them off Jazz, you know what I mean? See you there.
I'll sell you for 25.
Stay, I mean, are you looking forward to this, you know, fighting in your own city? Do you get that? Does it give you that buzz? Obviously, your mates are there and probably travel anyway, wherever you go to fight, but. Does it mean a bit more fighting there?
Yeah, definitely, yeah. I was on the last show in the Echo Arena. I was on quite late, like, so hopefully won't be on as late this time. But it is good. It's good for me to be on a big bill as well, because I'm probably the least fairest in my career on the whole bill. It's a good bill for me to be on and look up and think, I want to be top on a bill like this, you know what I mean?
How do you prepare for that? You know, when you see these bills, and obviously people going on early in the night, and if you're on later, how does your pre-fight routine change with it, you know, depending on where you're at? Or doesn't it?
I mean, it doesn't really. You've just got to, as soon as you get in there, you've got to be ready to fight whenever, you know what I mean? Like, when I was on last, Jazza was fighting as well, and so was Kevin Satchel. So
half
I was
12,
in, watching them both. Yeah, I didn't get in the ring for like half 12. You've taken the ring down as I was fighting, you know what I mean? I was on dead last, though. I was still ready, you know what I mean? It was all right. Get in and got the win. But,
Do you get a chance to say like Jazz is fighting earlier, or if Steve's fighting before you? Do you get a chance to watch it, or does that take you out of your headspace that you need to be in?
No, I mean, as long as there's enough time for you to get yourself ready before your fight, I can always pop out and have a look, you know what I mean? But if it was on next, I wouldn't be able to.
No, obviously, yeah.
be doing, put my gloves on outside the ring waiting to go in. But
there's something called float as well. When you get in there, they say you're on float, your first float or second float. That means you get in on a slot. So if they say, right, we've got 15 minutes now, you can go on for the 4 hour fight. So they put your wraps on at 6 p.m. and you mightn't get in the ring till like 12:30 in the night. So if you're on float, you can't watch the fight, can you?
No.
Is there ever an occasion when you're maybe on a build that you don't get to fight because of the time of, like, maybe the main event goes like over or whatever, and you are supposed to be on after them and you just don't get to fight?
Yeah, I mean, I have had a six rounder cut down to a four rounder.
Yeah.
I don't know if they take the whole fight off.
Just take it all the time. Yeah. It's like,
yeah.
Moving on to football, like, obviously, because that's what we're here for mainly. I mean, it hasn't been a great season for it. Well, it's been in and out for Everton, let's be honest. You'd hope it's been
more
great. And then league, we come back to league and it's rubbish. Steve, you've got a season ticket, so you might know a little bit more about this, but how have you found this season?
Shocking compared to last season, but you know, I don't know where within the Europa League as well. We've been playing well in there, but then just not doing it in the Premier League, so I don't know.
Do you still get the buzz going the match cup now that you're in boxing and you get yourself hyped up for the night? So, you know, as you say, fighting in front of your own crowd, do you still get the hype from going to Goodison? You know,
I mean, yeah, not as much as you used to, obviously, because you're not in the same position as what you was last season, but. Still looking forward to watching the match, but my hopes aren't as high as what's real.
Jazz, I read something about you saying that you've sort of lost the love for football. I mean, you said when you were a kid you were a big blue, but you sort of lost the love for that. And you know what? We're seeing that more and more. And what's it been for you? You know, that sort of sparked that off.
I don't know. Football was my first love. I always enjoy football, playing with the lads around the area and stuff like that. Played till I was under 15s, and when I got into weren't that it, I fell out of love with it. I just fell in love more with boxing. So when I do go to a game now, it's frustrating for me because no one throws a punch. So I do just still like going now and again. And I like watching matches today, but it's not a big passion for me no more. But I still do enjoy.
When you go and you do see the things that go on, you know, players falling over with a little bit of contact and the position you're in. And I suppose being, let's just say, coming into boxing, and you may have a few more little sly elbows going on in your boxing fight and maybe the highest of the highs. I mean, what does that make you feel like when you see that?
Sickening, isn't it?
Yeah, that's what does my head in. I can understand why people do fall out of love with football because of things like that. Well, it's just part of the game now, isn't it?
And as well, being boxers and being, as you say, we spoke about all the time, being in the city, you've got that connection. Is that another thing where in football we're starting to see less of a connection with the players on the pitch and the people in the stands? Obviously, the different levels of financial. And also for you lads, you have got to start at the bottom and work your way up. And it is a job and it is sport. Whereas you're watching football and you feel like people are looked after from like a kid all the way up. You know, that must be a little bit frustrating as well.
One of the things for me was the grassroots. You see a lot more foreigners now. I enjoyed football as a kid, playing on the field with my mates, and one of us would get took in by a club, and that was nice. I'd like to see that a lot more, looking after our own kids instead of the foreigners when we get to a certain age and stuff.
Yeah, we're seeing a lot more like investment going abroad, and you know, when there's plenty of kids in the city, we're probably being overlooked. I mean, especially some clubs, it's like a meat wagon. I've seen Chelsea today have sold one of the Hazards, and they've got a markup of 1500% on them. I mean, that just shows you how football's going. It's getting ridiculous. But as I say, it's the 6th of March. It is at the Echo Arena. Any numbers to plug? Have you got anything? You know, how can people get tickets for this fight? Through you, just come and see you.
Just through the Twitter, on Twitter.
Go on, what's your Twitter account so people can follow you?
Mine's
as well.
At Steve6Lewis.
Mine's at JazzyDickens10.
Get on there, follow them. They'll try and flog you some tickets, I'm sure.
Before we go, just the training. This is just, I'm just like curious about your training because we hear about these footballers being tired if they have to play 3 games a week, and we know they get massages and saunas and everything else up down in between. Just give us an example of your day's training. You've both been obviously working towards a fight, so what have you done today, basically?
We've got up this morning, went on our normal session in the gym, like we do CrossFit, but not doing that tonight. We've still got to do my run tonight. And then that's it for me Monday. So I've got to go down to Manchester in the morning, sparring. And then be coming back and doing my CrossFit again. But that's every day. We haven't got no one to rub us down in the gym.
So it's not 2 hour bit of jogging and yoga then, no one jazzy what's
I got up, got a manicure. No, same as Stevie. We all do the same camp together. I do a bit longer because I'm in a fight with more rounds, but just the same really, you know.
You got 12 rounds of sparring, so what you were saying? So.
Yeah, 12 rounds of sparring in the morning, so we just go to the gym. Yeah, every day is different, that's why the gym's so good. Got brilliant coaches and good people around us, and we can leave that side up to them. You know, we just focus on the training, so we're all happy in our gym.
And that's Everton Red Triangle Gym, isn't it? Just as well, I mean, there's a lot of people out there, I mean, a couple of years ago I was looking at it because, you know, you're looking at the training and all that. I mean, is that a kind of gym you can just walk in if you want and be taught as a kid, or, you know, can anyone just, is that for anyone, or is it mostly for kids and then fighters like yourself?
I think it's seven-year-olds, the coaches, they're in there all day. They're in there from 9 till about 2, and then they're back in from 4 till 8 p.m. So the coaches are in there all day long. They've got kids from 7 to about 10, and then 10-year-olds to senior, that can be any age, that's amateur, and then you've got the professionals as well, so they don't get a minute to themselves, but they are good coaches. If you're sending your kids anywhere, I'd advise it to be the Everton Red Triangle, because they have got good coaching down there.
And ambitions, lads, come on, think big, dream big, you said it before, but what's the overall ambition? Is it to be world
champion? It's got to be, yeah.
Of course, yeah.
Follow the dream.
And a night out in Vegas.
Yeah.
We all like after your fight. That's what we all want. Last question, just something that's just popped into my head. I don't know if you do it already, but what's your music when you come in?
I change mine. If the radio still is, you haven't took it down, because that's why, but I haven't got a set song.
No?
Just
something. Anything you'd really want though.
Everyone has their jobs. You're tempted to say Zaycars,
no? Tony, lend them your song. Jazz, anything for you? Any song that you're ready to use, or maybe something that hypes you up before you go out? Never mind a ring walk.
My one's Peter Gabriel, Salisbury.
Oh, I love that song.
It was either or Aqua, Barbie Girl.
After your manicure.
To go with your manicure.
Yeah. Right, big thanks to the lads, Jazz and Steve, for coming in. They are fighting Echo Arena, 6th of March. Make sure you get down there. Make sure you follow them on Twitter. Make sure you just give them all your support. They had a couple of blues as well, so, you know, that makes the difference. This has been Toffee TV from Baz, and for me, Ped. We'll catch you next time.